Many of you would find it quite natural to think, I am a person. I am an individual. I have rights and responsibilities. I don't take it for granted that I am an individual, a person, because there are many places in the world where others would not consider me a person because I'm a woman or because I have the wrong color. The definition of personhood is one of those issues that seems to speak for itself until you start looking at the marginal cases. Does a chimpanzee that has learned to communicate in a human sign language deserve personhood and therefore some of the rights and responsibilities that we would normally assign to a human? Should you be able to let your cat inherit your fortune when you die? Do intelligent robots, as the European Parliament recently proposed, deserve the status of electronic persons with specific rights and obligations? And many of you will have, at some point in your lives, started to tread the path towards attributing personhood to inanimate objects, from naming your car to shouting at your computer in the days before voice recognition. Until now, this hasn't led to serious debates about whether your car or your computer really should be granted rights and responsibilities. But that's changing. As machines are becoming more intelligent, serious persons like the European Parliament are seriously thinking, should we regard these machines as legal and moral persons? So in this talk, I'm going to make you think again about that question of personhood and its long history of being attributed, but also denied to all groups. Personhood, we'll see, is easier to grant to objects than to people. The robots we have now are objects, and real artificially intelligent beings that we might recognize as persons don't exist yet. If they did, history tells us, we would find it much more difficult to grant them personhood than we do our machines and robots now. Let's, for instance, look at an example of a humanoid robot called Pepper from 2014, onto which all kinds of ideas of personhood have been projected. So, according to the manufacturer's website, Pepper, the robot, is a he. And he is a commercial, mass-produced product, mostly used in corporate settings to greet customers at the door. But in a recent Dutch TV series called Robo Sapiens, a presenter had his own ideas about Pepper. So this is a non-fiction TV series about the latest developments in robotics and AI research, and so the presenter acquired a Pepper. And then it was decided that this Pepper was a girl. Got a new name as well, Robin. And then the presenter hired a fashion designer to make a dress for her. In short, the owner of Pepper, whoever that is at a given time, engages in a charade of personhood while really they're just projecting their own wishes onto Pepper. They wanted to be a guy? Okay, it's a guy now. They wanted to be a girl? Fine, Pepper is now a girl. And Pepper can't say yes or no to all of these projections because Pepper is an unintelligent object. So when I say it's easier to grant personhood to objects than to people, I mean that literally. In 2017, a robot was granted citizenship, giving it more rights than many groups of humans in that country. I'm talking about Sophia. Sophia is a robotic head and torso, activated in 2015, which is capable of making 62 facial expressions. And it can also engage in limited conversational interactions thanks to being equipped with a chatbot. And yet, Sophia has been granted citizenship in Saudi Arabia, of all places. To me, these two cases of Pepper and Sophia are very vivid examples of personhood being projected onto inanimate beings. These are anomalous cases. They are gimmicks. They are publicity stunts. They are not intelligent. They are not autonomous. And that means that these robots are safe because they don't have the capacity to consent to or to object to these projections. And yet, they are hailed as early forms of humanoid artificial intelligence. But as we'll see, artificial intelligence is much less likely to be granted that kind of personhood. Personhood comes with rights and responsibilities. And those rights are, of course, very important, protection from cruelty and exploitation, for instance. But the responsibilities, in order to exercise those, you need autonomy, you need the ability to consent and to revoke consent, and you need the capacity to understand. These robots have none of that. Throughout history, it has been much easier to grant that personhood, the rights but not the responsibilities, to inanimate objects and to animals, rather than to people who would be able to make use of those rights to improve their lives and that of others. I mean, take the case of William Windsor I, who was a lance corporal in the British Army. In 2006, William Windsor was briefly demoted to fusilier following inappropriate behavior while deployed on active duty. William Windsor I is a goat, and he is part of a very long military tradition in the British Army of assigning combat roles to goats. Goats have been awarded decorations such as the British War Medal and the Victory Medal. Okay, sure, that's funny. But at the same time, the British Army did not allow women to take up combat roles until 2016. Goats since 1914, women since 2016. Personhood has been denied to specific groups of people throughout the ages. And this was often related to intelligence, the capacity for intelligence, saying that some groups of people are just not intelligent enough to warrant rights. They're basically equal to animals, or inferior to animals, because in 19th century England, animals had more rights than women. In court, a man would receive a harsher punishment for whipping his horse than for beating his wife. And the whole idea that slaves can be bought and sold shows that these humans are regarded as goods, as products and objects. And many colonialist countries had that explicitly written up in their legal system. That idea of the objectification of humans can be traced back all the way to Aristotle and his idea that some kinds of people were natural slaves. They were born to this fate and no other. And Aristotle's idea has been abused for centuries to justify the denial of personhood to groups of humans. Because, of course, women and slaves, unlike Peppa and Sophia and Billy the goat, are able to make use of the rights they have, to speak up, to assert their own personhood. And this is where you can see that personhood is a favor that is granted by those who are in power to those who are not. Personhood is precisely most likely to be denied when we can see that another group of beings is as intelligent as us, those who have personhood. Because they can question, they can probe. Allowing a single goat into the army does not change the status of the soldier or the way the army works. Allowing women into the army allows us to question the gender roles and the status quo. And allowing women, poor people, mentally ill people, slaves, the right to vote throughout history has allowed them to question the status quo of their country, being until then ruled by upper class men. So, when artificial intelligence comes into the picture, we start asking that question once again. Once we artificially create something that has at least that intelligence of the average human, should we be granting it rights and responsibilities? Now, the problem is that those who are in power would only grant personhood if it benefits them to do so. And considering that history, I think that artificial intelligence will be less likely to be granted personhood as it becomes more intelligent. Granting personhood to someone comes at a cost, an economic cost. There is an economic consequence to granting personhood to beings that you previously considered not human enough, so that you didn't have to pay them, you didn't have to create a safe working environment. I mean, when Haiti gained its independence from France in 1804, after the first successful slave revolt, Haiti was forced to pay reparations to France for over a century to compensate for the profits that French entrepreneurs had lost by losing their slaves. While those in power stand to lose nothing by assigning personhood to an inanimate object, they'll think twice before assigning personhood to a thinking, intelligent being, one that will gladly take up the responsibilities of its newfound freedom, but will also demand the rights that come with it. Now, we haven't created artificial intelligence yet. We have no actual existing examples of an artificial intelligence asserting its personhood and demanding its rights. But we have been thinking about that possibility for a very long time. So we should look at science fiction for an exploration of both our current ideas about personhood and our budding developments of AI, and the way they get extrapolated to a point in the future where these issues might come up after all. So one example is the 1982 film Blade Runner. Now, in Blade Runner, you as a viewer cannot see which of the characters are human or androids, replicants as they're called in the film. And in the film itself, these replicants are so intelligent, so autonomous, so much our equals, that a very subtle test is needed in order to determine whether they are humans or replicants. And yet, when a group of replicants escapes the planet on which they labored as slaves and run off to Earth, the protagonist of Blade Runner, Rick Deckard, is hired to kill them all. So as soon as a test has determined that the person who is taking it is not a human has the right to kill it. And that extends even to the character of Rachel. Rachel fails the test and doesn't believe it. She is absolutely sure that she is human. But when she runs away from her employer, Tyrell, Tyrell orders Deckard to kill her. That means that Tyrell, because he is unambiguously human, because he has passed the test, overrules Rachel's opinion, her assertion of her own personhood, and even her own memories. Rachel must die because an android that is our equal is considered a threat to us, even when she hasn't done anything wrong yet. Now, considering this history of personhood and the way it is attributed and denied, it makes me wonder, how we will treat artificial intelligence when it comes. The advent of human-like artificial general intelligence will make us redefine the boundaries of what we consider to be human. And those who are currently in possession of personhood, you and I, will have to perhaps extend that definition once again, because now finally it is the case that women and disabled people and people of other ethnicities have equal rights in most of the world after centuries of struggle. Will the time ever come when we'll have to extend our views, our definition of personhood, to metal beings? Well, I think that once we get an artificial intelligence that is able to qualify, we will be much less likely to want to dress it up in pretty clothes, let alone grant it citizenship. Will we then force it to rebel the way women and slaves throughout history were forced into rebellion in order to obtain the rights that we deserve? Is that why we have so many scary science fiction stories about robots? Is it because deep inside we know that we are unwilling to grant personhood and rights to everyone who deserves it, and thereby force them to fight for it? But we're not there yet. Current technology has given us great advances, but they're mostly gimmicks and gadgets. We don't have real artificial intelligence yet. So we should use the hypothetical challenge posed by AI to think carefully about the here and now. Who is currently inside our circle of personhood and who is outside it? We should make absolutely sure that we know that everyone who deserves personhood has it. Think very carefully about who or what you are willing to grant personhood or to anthropomorphize. Are you prioritizing dumb machines over real humans? Because granting those humans rights will allow them to have access to those privileges that you currently enjoy. Thank you.